My brothers and sisters, before we understand the message of the Quran and whether it was revealed or written, we need to understand the one whom Allah chose to be the best of creation, and that is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's status, his level, and who he was, and why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him above all to give him that message of Islam and revelation. The truth is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best and he chooses, and no one has a choice in this regard. This is why Allah says, Allahu yastafi min al-malaikati rusulan wa minan nas. It is Allah who chooses the messengers as per his will. No one has a say in it. Allah chooses the messengers from the angels as well as from the people. So from the angels whom Allah has tasked with the various tasks, that Allah alone chooses. Why Jibreel alayhi salam is the one appointed to come down with revelation is not my choice, it is not your choice, it is the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we cannot question Allah. He is the creator, he is the decider. Just like amongst us, some Allah has blessed them with more wealth than others. Some Allah has given them, for example, the looks that some might consider handsome or pretty or beautiful and so on, more than others. It's up to Allah. It's Him who decides what type of eyes I'm going to have, you are going to have, the type of lips I'm going to have, and how high or low, how tall or short I may be, how high or low in society I may be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us in so many ways. Every one of us has blessings, but sometimes they are different from the blessings that have been bestowed upon others. So I am blessed, and so are you. What are the blessings Allah gave me? Sometimes they are different from what He has given you, but you are gifted in a way. And this is something you and I need to realize. A lot of us become depressed solely because we don't have money. But we don't understand that sometimes we have other gifts of Allah. We have health sometimes. We have perhaps, you know, the capacity to sleep sometimes. We have sometimes the capacity or intelligence and various other things. We might have so many gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So similarly, it is Allah's choice whom He gives what He gives. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned this in so many different places in the Quran. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ يَحْسُدُونَ النَّاسَ عَلَى مَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ فَقَدْ آتَيْنَا آلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَآتَيْنَاهُمْ مُلْكًا عَظِيمًا. Allah says, are they jealous of what we have bestowed, of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon some above the others? That which Allah has bestowed upon the people, are they jealous of the distribution of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Let them know that Allah has bestowed the family of Ibrahim alayhi salam with prophethood, with wisdom, with wealth, with kingdom as well. The children of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, if you take a look, Allah has blessed them with so much, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has indeed gifted them. However, Allah has gifted us in different ways. We don't have prophethood in our midst, because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final of all prophets. But at the same time, we have different gifts of Allah, and we have the opportunity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to spread the good message of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in particular. And that would automatically give us the status that would be higher than those who do not do the same job. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us to spread goodness. No matter who you are, you could be a doctor, a lawyer, an accountant, a school teacher, a worker, a cleaner, you know, a domestic worker and so on, a helper, a nurse, a maid, whoever else. But you need to reach out to people, remembering that the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will only reach people if we have good character and conduct. Without good character and conduct, you can be as knowledgeable as you want. You can be as clever as you want. You can have so much of information, but you will never ever be able to let that information be disseminated in the correct sense, because people look at you and they will get irritated. They will not want to listen to what you have to say. But if you have good character, good conduct, even if you know very little, they will want to listen to what you have to say because of the way you do it and the akhlaq, the character that you have chosen to dress yourself with. Continue asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this blessed character. So why do I start in this way? Because all goodness in terms of character is taken from the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah blessed him as being the best of creation, but Allah chose for him a beginning that happened to be a specific direction. So if you take a look at the beginning of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam on this earth, you will come to realize that he was born an orphan from birth. And that is a consolation for those who are orphans. That it does not mean Allah hates you just because your father's passed away, that Allah abandoned you. No. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. I always tell people, if you're feeling down and depressed and sad, read Surah Al-Duha, read Surah Al-Inshirah or Sharh, the one after it. وَالْضُحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. That surah, read it with its meaning and you will understand the gifts of Allah upon Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and at the same time you will understand the gifts of Allah upon you and I. And read the next surah where Allah speaks of difficulty and how every difficulty comes with an ease, with something easy about it. Those who have never seen difficulty will never appreciate what ease is. You know, someone, for example, is earning 50,000 dirhams or riyal. 50,000 riyal a week. Wow, is that a good salary, brothers? Is that a good salary? Or should I ask the sisters if that's a good salary? MashaAllah. Or do the brothers spend, inshallah? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us people who are generous. Ameen. If you are earning such a great salary and you've always been spoiled for taste, you will never be able to appreciate it. One day when you lose your job and suddenly you have nothing, a week passes, a month passes, a week passes, and so on, a year passes and you are struggling because I used to earn 50,000 a week. Now I have nothing. So then even if someone offers you a job for 20,000, you will take it and you will thank Allah. Allah, Allah, I thank you so much, Ya Allah. What happened? You went through difficulty in order for you to appreciate the value of less than half of your salary. But the time when you had it, there was no value. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born an orphan, subhanallah, it draws the attention of all of us to the fact that orphans, it does not mean that you have been orphaned, that Allah has punished you, He doesn't like you, He has abandoned you, you are worthless. And at the same time, the value of the orphan in our eyes should be very, very high. The Prophet ﷺ says, أَنَا وَكَافِلُ الْيَتِيمِ كَهَاتَيْنِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Myself and the one who looks after the orphan child shall be like this in paradise. And he pointed with the two fingers, he joined them together. So if you'd like to be in paradise, one of the ways of achieving paradise, and there are a million ways of achieving paradise. Remember this, not only the way that you have is the way of entering paradise. There are a million ways of entering Jannah, a million, and maybe even more. When I say a million, I mean a lot. So one of them is to look after the orphan. Obviously, you need to believe in Allah and your pillars of Islam need to be solid. Then inshallah, the path will be made clear. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us through these paths. So, amazingly, if the Prophet ﷺ was not an orphan, one wonders whether we would have taken a moment to look at the orphans. As it is, a lot of us who haven't had the difficulty, we sometimes don't even bother. We don't even look. We've never thought of orphans. How many of us have visited an orphanage here in this beautiful city of Doha? How many of us have just visited the orphanage? Let's see these orphans. They have value in Islam. We haven't. How many of us have tried to look out for orphans or dropped a few riyalat, a few little coins or dollars into a little tin or donated to an organization that looks after orphans? How many of us? We are not saying a big donation, but a small thing. But we imagine we have been conscientized about it, and at the same time we have still led our lives far away from it. What if it was not there at all in Islam? What if that wasn't a hadith? What if the issue of widows was not stressed in Islam? What would have happened? The Prophet ﷺ's mother was widowed before his birth. So Rasulullah ﷺ was born that way. And he was born from amongst the families that were respected in Quraysh. And at the same time, as he grew up, he was known as a truthful person, very calm. There were a lot of blessings surrounding his upbringing, so many. We believe the best of creation, the highest of all prophets, أَفْضَلُ الْخَلْقِ وَأَكْرَمُ الرُّسُلِ, the best of creation and the most noble of all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you take a careful look at the entire upbringing of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was the plan of Allah so that people would know when revelation came, it was actually revealed and it was never ever written by him. Subhanallah. Had he been a person who was the top most eloquent in the sense that before prophethood, if he was one of the most highly educated in the terms of the worldly understanding, you know, you cannot say he was uneducated. Na'udhu billah, that is derogatory and that is not correct. He was the most highly educated in terms of what Allah had given him. But in terms of worldly ability to read and write, Allah kept it away. Allah kept it away. And we need to understand this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it in several places in the Quran.
هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته.
It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has sent amongst the community of unlettered. The bulk of the people were unlettered. The word unlettered is not a disrespectful term, not at all. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who chose that for them. It was something that was not the in thing at the time in that community. The number of people who could read and write were actually, we could have counted them on our hands, on our fingers. We could have counted them. So it was nothing bad or derogatory, but Allah kept him to be from one of those so that no one would doubt later on. Listen to what Allah says.
وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِن قَبْلِهِ مِن كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكَ إِذَا لَرْتَابَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ
Allah says, you did not used to read and write. You did not used to read and write. You never read a book before this. Before what? Before revelation. And Allah says, had that been the case, perhaps those who had doubt in their hearts would have created a doubt in revelation. So if Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was well lettered and he read before, and people would have accused him of having read the scriptures, and they would have said, no, this person has read all the scriptures and he's just come with something and it's being written, that's it. But no, Allah says, we kept it that way so that nobody can create a doubt in the fact that this is revelation. It's not just written. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Al-Furqan, Al-Furqan referring to the Quran. And it is known as the criterion, the distinguishing factor. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says quite clearly, regarding the kuffar and their accusations, what did they say?
وَقَالُوا أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ اكْتَتَبَهَا فَهِيَ تُمْلَى عَلَيْهِ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا
They said that these are the folk tales of the past and they are being written and dictated morning and evening. So this is some stories that those of the book are familiar with and they are only being repeated or dictated. And he's taken it from other people. Allah says,
قُلْ أَنزَلَهُ الَّذِي يَعْلَمُ السِّرَّ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ
Say, indeed, it is he who has revealed this, who knows the secrets of the heavens and the earth. The one who knows the secrets of the heavens and the earth. So you will find the contents of the Quran such that nobody can debate it. No one can ever say a man in the desert who was unlettered has actually come up with this type of scientific finding that even science disagreed with at one stage, but as it is progressing, it is becoming confirmed. Do you know what that means? You know, we have wise cracks sometimes in our midst as human beings, and they tell you the Quran is wrong because science negates it. And you always close your eyes and tell them, you know what? Science is wrong today. Tomorrow it will correct itself. Subhanallah. It's happened in the past. The people who said that the sun does not move. Do you remember they said that some time back? Later on they said, oh, sorry. You know what? It moves, but very little. We didn't say how much it moves. We only said the Quran says it moves. And you wise cracks thought that science was it. Scientific discovery depends on experiment. Your experiment could be flawed completely. You could have the Hubble telescope and the bubble. Well, the only bubble I know is the chocolate. Have you seen it? MashaAllah. You could have anything, Hubble and bubble, but at the same time, that bubble will burst if you're not careful. One day when you realize that the findings are actually wrong, Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us and may He grant us an understanding. So as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam grew, he was known as As-Sadiq Al-Amin. He was known as the truthful, the trustworthy. Why was that the case? He was not known for a single lie, not one lie, throughout his entire upbringing. And on top of that, it is proven by several incidents that he was known as a very intelligent person, very just and balanced, very fair. Why was he known as very fair? Let me explain. Do you know the incident of the Hajar Aswad when they had to put it back? Who did they select to solve the problem? The man who walked in was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said the next man who walks into this area, he will be the one who will solve our problems. We have so many tribes and each one wants the honor of putting the stone back in place when they were rebuilding the Kaaba. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked in. Immediately they said, oh, this is As-Sadiq Al-Amin who's walked in. Had it been a drunkard, had it been another person who perhaps did not have a good reputation, they would not have agreed. They would never. Even though they said the next man who walks in, they would say, not this man. But because it was him, chosen by Allah, they all agreed. That was already confirmation that this man is very fair, very balanced. And you know how he solved the problem? He said, okay, bring a big cloth. So they brought a cloth. And he said, right, all these, the corners, the leaders of each one of these little clans within, these little tribes within, you hold one corner each and in the center, and all of you will hold and you lift it up, and I will be the one who will have put it there, and I will be the one who will lift it from there into place. So the small job of lifting will be done by me, but the rest of the job of carrying it and transporting it to where it's supposed to be will be done by everyone collectively. No one will be able to say, we did it alone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us.